Boston. Boston. Representing Mass.
Boston cats have a hard time for whatever reason. The talent is here. I mean, we have one of the top three or four scenes in the country.
And for a long time, Boston had no hip-hop industry. There was no record labels, there were no promoters, there were no radio shows. Guru leaving set the tone. You can't make it from Boston, and that you need to move to New York to make it.
You know, there was nobody at all helping out Boston artists. So it took a slow but sure process for artists to stay here, record here, release singles here, develop, and, you know, all of a sudden see that there's a good possibility that they could succeed here.
It's a very tight community of artists, which is great, and I think that by and large, artists really go out of their way to support each other.
Boston is a pretty intellectual place, man. Cats really, like, want to see people express themselves. And the hip-hop has caught on here at such a fast rate over the last 3 or 4 years that there's always somebody new rhyming.
Shit is dope tonight. I'm feeling B-Town. I need to hear you. All right.
Hip-hop was in such an infant form that, you know, everybody was interested in it. So you could be a local group back in the 80s and perform at a club and everybody would come to see you. And you didn't have no record, you didn't have nothing, but everybody was there to see you.
The problem is there really wasn't a hip hop scene in the early days. There were little pockets where, you know, groups emerged, especially Dorchester, you know, Mattapan.
Representing Lord Town Mass, I come to blast. I could drop math or walk the psychopath. I break a molecule in half, blast my tool to laugh.
The out of town posse, you know, there was a group called Double Def, which turned out to be Top Choice Click, who, you know, went on to do some pretty big stuff. You know, of course, Almighty RSO.
Almighty RSO, who had tremendous problems with the police in this town, as per usual, you know, I mean, it's a very conservative town, and at that time, you know, one misstep, and, you know, there was trouble.
Early as like 85 or 86, we're putting out records on, must have been their own label called Boot. They put out a couple singles. Orange Man was around at the time. TDS Mob came around like 88.
The group that I was in, Fresh to Impress, man. I remember we did a Boston Goes Deaf. That was like the unofficial first Boston compilation.
Pretty much, you know, it stayed kind of as a local thing, basically until, you know, Ed OG dropped the bomb.
I pump bomb on the car with no alarm and never thought that it would get to my mom's. But when she found out, she made me take the pound out and get out with it. Man, I could forget it. Only 17 and got my own crib. And still learning how to live on the streets of the ghetto.
NOG is the man. NOG was the guy who made everyone in Boston realize that you could make it big and be from Boston.
I made a couple of records in 86 and 87 locally. You know, head didn't do too much. And from there, we just kept working on our demo. I hooked up with Joe Mansfield. He had a studio and we started recording.
Around 89, I met up with Ed playing some tracks and, you know, he was failing some of the tracks. I played him and we were recording stuff just to a regular cassette deck with a mic.
I took it to my cousin's Awesome 2 in New York and they got us a deal.
Edo's success was probably, to this day, the most significant thing that's happened as far as Boston hip-hop goes.
I remember the day that I first saw that video, and I was like, oh, this beat's ill. Who's this? And I'm watching a video, and I see Dudley Square flash in the background. It's N.O.G., all right.
The video, you know, for I Gotta Have It was on MTV every day, which just basically brought a Boston artist to national and, you know, international audience. Look, but don't touch, and if you do, be prepared, G, to go out. Just like your first day off punishment, the Bulldog Trucks Ferry in Boston is what I represent. The Black United Leaders living directly on Grooving Sounds. At first, you didn't know us, but now it's like, yo, put me down. We didn't get in there so you can get in with us. You wasn't down, we was riding the bus. So put on your Adidas and step off. I got to have it.
Number one Yo MTV Raps. Number one Billboard. Toured the world. Went gold, almost, at a time when people didn't sell records like that. I mean, I Gotta Have It is, you know, gotta be one of the top 20 hip-hop songs of all time.
Dude, man, I was like so young when I did it. You know, you have to look back on it now, look back at tapes and look at stuff to really know the impact. Back then, I didn't, you know, it didn't even cross my mind. I didn't even know what a number one record in the country was at the time.
Hearing it on the radio, seeing the video, knowing that he's representing, you know, Boston, Mass, and he being from Massachusetts, it meant a lot, you know what I mean? He was a big influence on me.
You know, he did impeccable work, he got recognized for it and brought light to the city. You know, he paved the way for all of us cats that are trying to do our thing right now.
He's just like a regular guy, and even in his lyrics, he's expressing things that, you know, people go through. When a brother makes a child and then denies it, thinking that money is the answer, so he buys it. A whole bunch of gifts and a lot of presents. It's not the presence, it's your presence and the essence of being there and showing the baby that you care.
If you make a song for a pop station, strictly for pop music, then to me, you're selling out. But if you make a strictly hardcore hip-hop song and it crosses over, cool, get paid. But don't make no strictly sellout music.
Yeah. Tricks up my sleeves, chicks can't believe, and when it's over, they don't want to leave. The Vita, gladdest night they ever had when the pip hits the tip. I love to see you going.
After his second record really didn't do very well, and the label kind of folded, and he was without a deal, and then he came back here, sort of people saw that things were changing, and that, you know, he was the guy who made it nationally, but then things really went down for him.
Yeah, we just want to let y'all know, you know what I'm saying, that the album will be out in January. Yeah. You know, it's not our fault that it took so long to come out. It is the record company's fault.
With the label at the time that I was on, they were like on a downslide because they had signed so many other groups and they had put like a lot of money into groups that didn't do anything. So their relationship with Mercury was kind of bad, you know, at going into that time. And you know, I mean, it's all business. It's stuff that I couldn't control that was over my head.